May the peace of Christ be with you. Welcome to worship with Crescent Hill Baptist Church. We are glad you have decided to join us. Let us begin with prayer. Holy God, we bring ourselves before you now. Teach us through your word. Create in us clean hearts through your presence within us. Renew within us a spirit of righteousness and love. May we recognize the holy, inside and out. On this Sabbath day, may our souls rest in true knowledge of you. May our lives resound with true wisdom from you. And may our actions reflect true discipleship for you, mediating your presence further into the world. Rise up within us and pour yourself out around us, that we might more fully enter into your kingdom in the moments ahead. Take our hearts and form them. Take our minds and transform them. Take our wills and conform them to yours, O Lord. It is in the name of Jesus, the Holy One of God, whose glory fills the skies, Christ the true, the only light, we pray. Amen. Now join us in singing, Christ whose glory fills the skies.
Christ whose glory fills the skies, Christ the truth, the only light, Son of righteousness, arise, triumph over shades of night. Day spring from on high be near, day star in my
Our gospel lesson today comes from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, verses 21 through 28. They went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, he entered the synagogue and taught. They were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Just then there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying with a loud voice, came out of him. They were all amazed, and they kept on asking one another, "What is this, a new teaching with authority? He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." At once, his fame began to spread throughout the surrounding region of Galilee. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. now time for the children's moment. Good morning, boys and girls. Has your room at home ever been really messy? What happens then? I bet your parents say something like, "Go clean up your room." What kinds of things do you usually have to clean up? Books, toys, clothes, headphones, stuffed animals, art supplies, games. Many people know that my office is sometimes very messy. There are books and study materials, craft supplies, and currently there are items for the Lent take-home bags and all sorts of stuff around my office. But here in the sanctuary, it is almost always clean. If items are left on the pews, we make sure and pick them up before we meet again. Just like when we have messes in our rooms, we can also have messes inside of us. A mess inside of us might look like anger or hatred or meanness, or it might look like hurt feelings or sadness or distrust or anxiousness. And a lot of times, we think we're supposed to clean those inside messes up all on our own. We might even think that we need to clean up our messes before we can come here to church. Or maybe we think we need to hide our messes when we come to church because it's so clean and we wouldn't want to mess it up. But in today's scripture story, we see someone in Jesus's faith community who decides to spill their inside mess right in the middle of the worship service. The story calls the mess an unclean spirit. But do you notice how Jesus responds to this person's mess? Jesus didn't get mad or upset with the person. Instead, Jesus helped the person clean up his mess right then and there. Although this sanctuary is almost always clean, that doesn't mean that we have to have everything cleaned up in our own lives to be here. In fact, our faith community can actually help us, with God's guidance and love, clean up our messes just like Jesus did in today's scripture story. Not only do we not have to be all cleaned up to be part of the church, we can invite others in our faith community to know about our messes. Then together and with God's help, we can work together to clean up our mess. And that's pretty good news for today. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for Jesus coming and showing us your healing love. And thank you for helping us clean up our messes. Amen. The Gospel of Mark is the shortest of the four Gospels. If you read the Gospel in its entirety, you will notice a quick-paced narrative recording one event after another. The Gospel of Mark has no birth story recorded. We begin with Jesus being blessed and baptized by John, hearing a voice, "You are my beloved child, with you I am well pleased." The next event Mark records is the Spirit driving Jesus into a 40-day temptation in the wilderness. Then a trip to the Sea of Galilee, where he begins his public ministry by recruiting his first disciples. The next thing we are told is that Simon, Andrew, James, and John follow him into the synagogue in Capernaum on the Sabbath. This is where we pick up the narrative this morning. Jesus is teaching in the synagogue. Everyone says he's teaching with such power and authority. Then a man with an unclean spirit comes in. Who is this man with an unclean spirit that shows up in the synagogue today? He's loud. He interrupts. He draws our attention the way any loud, obnoxious, inappropriate, irritating, interrupting person would do in an otherwise calm gathering. The man with an unclean spirit is, for many of us, I suspect, the shocking and intriguing part of today's gospel. Ironically, he does not have that same effect on the people in the synagogue. Their attention seems to remain on Jesus. They are astounded by his presence and teaching. It's like nothing they have ever heard before. Jesus has authority. His words mean something. They make a difference. Even the man with an unclean spirit is shocked and intrigued by Jesus, asking, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth?" Jesus is teaching in the synagogue. His authority fills not just the place, but each person there. And almost immediately, this man with an unclean spirit shows up. The presence of Jesus, the man with a clean spirit, draws out the presence of the man with an unclean spirit. Jesus has that effect on people. His authority and teaching reveal the truth about his listeners' lives. I'm not going to debate what an unclean spirit means. Was it a demon? Was it some sort of mental health issue? Does this man have a momentary break with reality? Or was this man just a loud, obnoxious, irritating person that simply didn't follow social norms? I'm not sure what ailed this man who showed up in the synagogue. And I'm not sure that it even really matters today. What does matter is that he needed Jesus. This man with the unclean spirit needed Jesus to make him whole again and restore him to his community. Whatever caused this man's brokenness is also causing this man to be broken off from his community. He is the outsider. He is the outcast. He is the other. And in a way, he is broken off and alienated from himself. We have all been there at some point. We have all been the broken one. We have all been cut off from our community. We have all been the outsider or the outcast. We have all felt those moments when we feel completely isolated, even isolated from our true self. Take a couple minutes and look back over your life. What are your stories of being alienated? What is your first memory of that? What is your most recent memory of that? When have you felt like a stranger in your own skin? We all have those moments when we say something, think something, do something that makes us stop and think, "That is not who I am. Those are not my thoughts, words, or actions." I think we all live at times as women and men with unclean spirits. There are those times when we betray our own integrity, when we are confused and lost about who we are or who we want to be, When we look at our life and don't recognize ourselves or like what we see. Or maybe we want our life to be different. We want to stop causing trouble and difficulty for ourselves. We want to be more or different than what we have become. I think that's what it's like to live with an unclean spirit. By unclean spirit, I don't mean that we are bad people, defective human beings, or hopeless sinners. I just mean that we've turned against ourselves. We've turned away from the truth. We've become confused about ourselves and lost. It happens in so many ways and so easily. It sneaks up on us. It happens to us not only as individuals, but collectively. That seems to be what much of the craziness in our world today is about. We are living lost to ourselves. Countries, governments, churches, businesses, organizations, and groups are estranged from themselves. It's all described here in today's gospel. What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? The man with the unclean spirit asks. This man senses the distance between his life and Jesus's. He knows his spirit is broken. He knows he is outside his community. His words tell of his isolation. It's not, however, just about him. He speaks not only for himself, but for all those in the synagogue that day. He represents everyone who has ever experienced the brokenness of life. He is the spokesperson for all who feel disconnected from themselves, others, and God. He represents all those who have found themselves to be the outsider. Behind his question is, I believe, the unspoken longing and hope that Jesus would say, everything. I have everything to do with you. Those are the words that can begin to put his life back together. We're not so different. Each one of us longs for that answer because we too know the separation and brokenness of our own lives. We've lived in isolation. We have been trapped in grief. We have carried the burden of guilt. The truth is, we all need healing and restoration. Throughout all of Jesus's ministry, throughout all of Jesus's teachings and healings, Jesus is reconciling people to God, to themselves, and to the community. Jesus, throughout his ministry, is putting the pieces back together in the lives of the individual and the lives of the community. Jesus always stands before us as the image of unity, wholeness, and integration. He is the stronger one. He does for us what we cannot do for ourselves. He puts our lives and houses back in order. Jesus offers a different image of what life might look like. He does so by revealing the division in our lives, the houses that cannot stand, and the crumbling of our kingdoms. Even when it is for our own good, with the offer of new life and intended for wholeness, it's a hard place to be. It means that one way or another, change of some sort is coming, and that can be frightening. It's hard to look at the division and inner conflict within our own lives. The beginning of wholeness, however, is acknowledging our brokenness. Where is our own spirit broken? How and to what extent have we created conflict and division within our relationships? In what ways do we live fragmented lives, parceling out pieces here and there? What is it that shatters your life? Anger, resentment, greed, insecurity, perfectionism, sorrow and loss, fear, envy, guilt, loneliness? There are all sorts of forces, things, events, sometimes even people by which our lives are broken and through which we are separated from God, from others, and from ourselves. Christ is stronger than anything that fragments our lives. He binds the forces that divide. heals the wounds that separate and refashions pieces into a new whole. There is nothing about your life or my life that cannot be put back together by the love of God through Christ. Amen.
Please join me in prayer. As we have read and learned from the Psalms, our God to whom we pray is righteous, gracious, and merciful, faithful and just, provider of our needs, and the most holy. It is to this God we have lifted our hearts in praise with our family of faith called Crescent Hill Baptist Church this day in a sanctuary spread across this world. We thank you for this community of faith and keeping us close through the miracle of internet, Wi-Fi, cell phones, computers and tablets, apps and websites. We thank you for new children born into our church, for the hope they bring, and that they remind us that we are all part of one human race, more alike than different, with the same needs and enough love to share with the whole world. We are thankful for the ministers and staff and members of the community of faith that teach, train, counsel, and guide our children and youth, as well as the grown-ups, so we may find our calling and place of service. We give thanks for people who have faithfully given out of their wealth and those who have given from their need. Bless the giver and the gift. We thank you for leaders in government, religious organizations, civic groups, charities, and businesses that understand that the resources of the world are more than adequate to ensure that every person's needs are met, that change is good, the future is not to be feared, that racism is real and destructive to all, and what we call justice is not equally applied. We pray for leaders that do not strive to be servants to people, but only serve themselves to gain power, control, and wealth. May their hearts be broken and their eyes open to all the pain, sickness, and need in the world. May they understand what is required of those who have more than they will ever need. So God, we pray for the hungry and those who need clean water. May we share from what we have so that their needs will be met. We pray for the sick. May we offer help and support as needed. God, of people who grieve the loss of husband or wife, mother or father, a child, a brother or a sister, a best friend, or a special person that was their strength and support, help us who grieve to acknowledge the pain, the void, the need to speak and tell others of our loss, so our grief may find voice and release. As your people, O God, help us to be present for those who grieve with open hearts and ears, so we may bear their grief with them. For our brothers and sisters who endure to this day discrimination, who most often have not been allowed to fully enjoy their rights of liberty and pursuit of happiness, who receive less resources than people of privilege, we ask you to help us find courage to stand up and beside them for their rights and for true justice. God, may all who are captive to hate, discrimination, power, and unjust treatment be freed. And for all who have been cast aside, may they find a place at your most holy and sacred table. May this community of faith learn how to do the hard work to bring about justice, so we are a safe place for young and old, the man and the woman, the native and the refugee, the gay and the straight, for the just and the unjust, the Democrat and the Republican, the abused and the abuser. May we find strength together around your table with each other, even our enemies. May we help the discriminated and the discriminator come together around the table so your perfect love and peace can be experienced between them and that healing may begin. God, we know that we have much to do before true justice can find flame and burn bright. Push us forward to share your love and stand for fairness and equal treatment. And as we continue to move forward, we will join together and pray as one church the prayer Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen.
Once again, thank you for joining us for worship this morning at Crescent Hill Baptist Church. A few announcements before we conclude today. First of all, as has become customary, we will be providing an opportunity for folks to pick up a prepared meal on Tuesday. If you would like to receive one, please notify us via email or leave a message in the church office by 5 p.m. today on Sunday. I hope that you will take advantage of some of the opportunities for gatherings that are before us this upcoming week. On Wednesday, Dr. Henson is leading a study that is taking place via Zoom from 10:30 until noon. Then on Wednesday evening this week, beginning at 6 o'clock, we will gather for our weekly prayer meeting. And as a part of our gathering this Wednesday night, Louis will be taking requests of some of your favorite hymns that he will then play a verse or two for us when we are gathered on Wednesday evening. Note that we are drawing near to the Lenten season. Ash Wednesday is February the 17th, and we have some plans ahead for Ash Wednesday and the Lenten season that I think that you all will appreciate and enjoy. So stay tuned for some ways that you can connect and engage with us as we move into the Lenten season. Hear now these final words of blessing and benediction. The road ahead is long and our time is short. And we know that what awaits us out there will be some days of darkness and despair. But as you go forth, know that God's gracious face always shines upon you, and that the love of this fellowship always surrounds you, so that you might do your best this day and every day to tell and show someone you love them, forgive someone you need to forgive, stand up for what is right and just, help feed someone who comes to you hungry, and continue to live in the abundant and yet audacious hope that you too are being redeemed. Amen.